presentation since. As they say in the Oscars, Christos Laskos can't be with us today. We haven't got a video of him saying why he can't be here, but he sends his comradely greetings and regards, and he's the co-author of the book. And it's a book about ideas and alternatives. And Christos and I have probably, since the crisis began, not the Greek crisis, but the world crisis in 2008, have presented ideas and arguments to over 150 meetings in Greece. Union meetings, Syriza meetings, cultural group meetings, and we've discussed these issues, and we thought that we would do one now for an audience that is that can speak English, because a big part of the story we want to say is that this is a crisis, a world crisis, and the response is going to be at a supranational level, and we at least feel it is terribly important that Britain and in Spain and Portugal understand what the issues are, and they don't see it just through the media. So it's a book about ideas and alternatives. Let me start with ideas. It's an attempt basically to debunk the ruling ideology. In the book we call it the dominant narrative of what the crisis is. Hilary's already hinted at this, that Greece is a special case. And to the narrative there is a morality tale. The morality tale is that Greeks consume more than they produce, they're always interested in sharing out the pie rather than increasing the pie. It's a subset of the European-wide morality tale with a Calvinist twist of Merkel, of the hard-working North, which is thrifty and hard-working, and the South, which is lazy and spendthrift. The first point I want to say about ideas and the dominant narrative is when you say the ruling ideology, it's not the ideology of those ruling. Yes, the whole point of a ruling ideology is that the rule, the dominated, to some extent at least, accept some of the tenets of the argument. So in Greece we have this appalling politician from Passos, who's called Pangalos, who said that we all had our noses, snouts in the trough. Is that the right? That's how I've translated a very Greek expression, so that it was an exercise, and a very successful exercise, I would say, in sharing guilt. Everybody responsible for this crisis, so we've all got to get out of it in the way that the Troika and the austerity policies have been doing it. So in the book we argue, and I can't go through all the arguments, we can discuss anything in questions, that it's a world economic crisis, that Greece isn't exceptionalism, that it's a capitalist crisis, and it's a crisis of the Eurozone that is distinctly, was distinctly and is distinctly unable to meet that crisis. We argue that it's not a debt crisis, that the debt is a consequence, not the cause of this crisis. Here is the one area where Greek exceptionalism has some cachet. It captures, because Greek debt did increase before the 2008 crisis, whereas in other countries it didn't. Our argument is that the causation is wrong. We're influenced by arguments that have been made that this is not just an economic crisis, it's a crisis of democracy. One of the things that's happened in capitalism since the 70s is that all types of debt have increased more or less linearly. That there's a small period in the 90s when that isn't true, so there's the debt, the private debt, the public debt goes like this, there's a small evening up of that, and then it continues. And why is that? Because modern capitalism doesn't seem to be able to spread the goodies of capitalism in the way it did in the 50s and 60s. So a part of the crisis in Anglo-Saxon countries was through debt, through borrowing. Yes, I remind you that the sort of junk bonds were bonds originally to the poorest of the poor in America. Yes, so they did it through private debt. We don't have in Greece such a developed financial system, so it did through public debt, through the state trying to spread the goodies. And so we say it's a similar phenomenon. It's addressing, and what is the what is it addressing? It's the why do I call it a reverse causation argument? It's not as if we have successful neoliberal economies, and in Greece, that successful neoliberal economy was sidetracked by clientelism and a big bad state. It was the reverse. Because that capitalism that we argue was a neoliberal capitalism wasn't creating enough jobs and enough security through pensions, taxable income to do pensions, the state, through clientelistic purposes, what was spending to try to spread the goods. It wasn't viable in Greece, it wasn't viable in the Anglo-Saxon countries. So we say that Greece was on the eve of crisis in the neoliberal economy. It did all the range of neoliberal measures, flexible labour markets, privatisations. All these things were part of the package. As in all countries, there were rear guard actions by trade unions and others, and stopped the full flow of the neoliberalism. So it's not a linear story. If I had more time, so there were rear guard actions, because of course the same Pangloss would say that, you know, the unions and the leftists opposed all reforms. Reforms, of course, here means a specific, it's not a general word. Reform here means the opposite of what you, the older amongst you, remembered what reform was. Reform used to be labour protection, the welfare state, pensions. Now it means exactly the opposite of that. So one of the things we then discuss is, well, why Greece first? And why has the Eurozone been so tough on all the southern European economies? Why is that? Well, for Greece first, on one side, we know the answer. About a month ago, the Wall Street Journal, this isn't in the book, had the leaks of the IMF discussion of Greece's first memorandum of understanding, the first package of support. Yeah? And what it said was that at least 40 central bankers said that this was not a deal and a package to help Greek economy. It was a deal and a package to help northern banks. Yeah. And they said it then, not now. This is a leak of the discussions of March, April of 2010 for the Greece going into the IMF Troika program in 2010. Yeah. And even a Swiss banker, for God's sake, you would expect the Swiss banker to support banking interests, wouldn't you? You'd think that even the Swiss banker says this is an appalling program, it'll help German and French banks, it will do nothing to help Greece. So we know from their side, but why did the Greek government of PASOK so easily go in? And in the book we have a dual hypothesis. We play with two hypotheses. One is structural incompetence. We call it the structural incompetence hypothesis. And the other one is the class instinct hypothesis. The structural, and this is actually explains not only why Greece went into the memorandum, it also is an attempt to explain why European policy has been as poor and as bad as it has been. Why has it insisted on austerity when it hasn't been working? So the structural incompetence hypothesis says that there's a cognitive locking. People get used to neoliberal ideas. They don't think there's anything else. They actually believe it. They believe the ideas. It's a mistake to think that all your opponents are cynical. Yes, I mean, it's one thing to say the Catholic or the Orthodox Church supports capitalism or supports the ruling class. It's quite another to say that they were created to support that. Yet priests, or at least a big part of the priesthood, has to believe for it to do its ideological role. Yeah, if they're all cynical, people would realise. So part of the thing is this cognitive locking, which has created a structure that is completely inadequate to dealing with these big financial problems that the Eurozone has. So we call that the structural incompetence hypothesis. And then the other one is the class instinct hypothesis, which is much easier, and I think this is the audience to understand. It says, never let a good crisis go wasted. This is the time to really use the neoliberal agenda, reduce wages, reduce pensions, hollow out the welfare state. This is our opportunity. Now, that class instinct, we think, was more important than the structural incompetence, although we think both were important. But just because it's class instinct, it doesn't mean it's going to work. And there's no sign yet. So you can say that the class instinct is working in the sense that wages are being reduced, the welfare state is being narrowed it further, pensions are being reduced, but that doesn't make it a stable equilibrium. A stable equilibrium would be a phase of capitalism where there was some growth, profits could be high, wages could be low, but some of the goodies have to be spread to some of the middle and working class. Yeah? It's not a viable strategy. In our view, that's the view of the book, it might be wrong view, that maybe democracy's last year's thing and maybe people won't resist, but it's not a stable equilibrium so far. Am I speaking a lot more than caution?
No, you're all right.
So I'm coming to the...
I've been so absorbed.
Okay, so that's the ideas. So ideas are not just about the dominant groups, it's about the dominated who accept that. But the second thing about ideas and the dominant narrative is to block out alternatives. That's what ideas do. You know, what's ideology do? It's supposed to say there is no other way. We all remember Tina and Thatcher and so on, that there's no other way, there's no new thinking. And, you know, I've been in Parliament for 1.5 years. Parenthesis. I can have an extra minute for this parenthesis. I read Rosanna Rosander's autobiography, which goes up to 68 and the creation of the manifesto, and she said we in the PC in the Communist Party used to send only the dropouts and the politically troublesome to the Parliament. No serious communists. And I can understand, and I think it's a sensible
statement.
I don't know if it applies, but I would like to get out because it really is a very tricky. Anyway, that's the parenthesis is over. So in Parliament, every speech of every government, pro-government MP ends, there's no alternative. You haven't got an alternative, nothing will work, you can't negotiate, you just want to go back to the state that we created. That's always a bit difficult for them because they say that you want to go back to the clientelism that we so proudly created. But it's still strong. It's still strong. Yeah, to the extent it's a powerful argument, it does create. And so what is our, we have three, I can only say in very schematic form, three aspects of our alternatives, which we've been discussing in the Greek left. A parenthesis here is that these ideas did come out as Marxist theory, epistemology says it should come out. So chapter 5 of the book is a range of social movements that started together with the crisis from all sorts of things, from the can't woke pay movement, for the movement of social solidarity of people in crisis, the movement of young people in December of 2008, the phenomenon of the squares that was in Cairo and Barcelona and Madrid and so on. So a lot of these ideas did come out from people asking questions from social movements. So we want to block it, and then what? So a social movement is never entirely negative, yeah? Because immediately you say, I've got to block this route, the next question comes, and so what do you want to do? And so a lot of these ideas were tested. Of course, was in the town squares discussing things. I was in one of the town square meetings. So these ideas, and we have had a vibrant debate, and I want to finish off with certain lessons from that debate. The first thing is internationalism. We think that Syriza is lost in a straight battle, Greece versus Germany. We think that isn't on. I in particular, but Christos to a certain extent as well, have been very influenced by the failures of the left in Europe in the 70s and the 80s. I was involved in a minor way as a supporter of the alternative economic strategy in Britain in the early and the late 70s. I've written about the common program of the left in France, and I've written about PASOK. All those three experiments, 1976 in Britain, 1983 in France, 1985 in Greece, led to financial crisis when and strategy changed. Yes, so dealing with financial markets and multinational corporations, we've been there before, the strategies, the national roads seem to have failed. So part of our argument is that we need an international flavour to any alternatives. So you need a strategy for dealing financial markets and multinational corporations, and just a sort of a Greek road to socialism, where you start with exiting the euro and doing your own national strategy, seems to me a straight rerun. I haven't got time to explain it to what I experienced in Britain in the 70s, what was experienced in France in the 80s, and so on. The second is that the class structure of Greece is not as it is imagined by official orthodox Marxist groups, the 200 families. You know? The enemy is much bigger than that. This idea of a sort of monopoly capitalist, state monopoly capitalist thesis, where you know, you've got the baddies who are quite small, the big industrialists and the big banks, and if you can deal with them, then socialism is closer. The French used to speak about the top 200 families and how important it was if you took over this firm and that firm and that bank and that, and that, and that, that seems to be us. And finally, it's not only not about taking over some firms and some banks, is you've got to know what to do with them.
Yep.
Yeah, that seems to be another thing of that came out from our discussion in 1978. Hilary was in Greece over the summer, and in a lecture she gave, she said the most successful anti-privatization campaigns were those that said how terrible it would be if water savers privatized, because water is important, it's a social good and right. But it also said we're not going to return the company to how it was run before. We have a new vision of how it's supposed to be run. So those are things that within the debate, within the Greek left, there were lots of positions in that. Syriza, and I'm not here to support Syriza's position, although our book is pro-Syriza and it supports it, and obviously I'm the economic spokesman in Parliament for it, so I can't say I'm a sort of independent bystander. But these ideas have influenced the Syriza programme, which I won't say now because it's not the thing, so you can ask me about that, but these ideas that I've tried to say. So our major thing, and I'll finish with this, is that if and when a Greek government is formed, we're 27%, we're neck and neck in some polls, ahead in some of the other polls, that we want to negotiate a new deal for Europe, and we will be asking for the help of the whole of the South in the first instance, and northern working people and other social groups in the north at a second level, because we believe that what is wrong is, and I go back to the beginning, that it was a capitalist crisis, it's a Eurozone crisis, the architecture, the economic and financial architecture of the Eurozone, and that the way to approach this, that doesn't mean Greek left stop doing it till everything changes, but to spark off a serious debate. So we hope to have demonstrations in our favour, not only in Athens, but in Madrid, and in Rome, and in Dublin, and in Lisbon, and if we can do that, then I think the
London.
Yeah, that. I'm an optimist, but I'm not that optimistic sometimes. Okay, I'll finish
that.
You know, I don't know whether it's getting old and therefore maybe more curmudgeonly, but these days I rarely read a book that I wholeheartedly agree with. But this book is an exception. I've read with genuine pleasure and a great deal of benefit this book, precisely because I had kind of feared that any book, as so many other books are written at a level of abstraction, detached from the actual interplay of real social forces in all their complexity, because not only so much of our approach to these questions on the left being characterized by excessive abstraction and oversimplification of the political and social dynamics that work out when you have a real crisis. So I really recommend the book, not least, I mean, there are many things to say about it, but one of them, which I found fascinating, was that some of the most important acts of resistance and demonstrations came from issues that you might think were secondary, marginal, inverted commas, to the central question of the economic crisis. They're obviously linked with it. Issues around basically civil society, forms of resistance on specific ecological, women's issues, all kinds of questions that wouldn't have been predictable from a simplistic model of the crisis that we often talked about as coming in our political lifetimes, actually is with us now. There is an irony, when we were much stronger, the crisis didn't come, and it's now happened when, in general, and with some important exceptions like Greece, we are much less politically and organizationally to face it, and that's something that we have to confront openly. Now, the crisis that Euclid and his co-author develop in this, the analysis they develop in this book, is particularly important because it, in my opinion, indicates how the different political forces that make up the ruling class intertwined with the neoliberal doctrines in ways that were largely unpredictable to some extent. And I believe that, myself, I'd be interested to know what Euclid thinks of this, as the crisis matures and deepens in many ways in the so-called recovery phase, and there will be some kind of recovery in the sense that output will probably stabilize, there may be some very feeble form of economic growth, unemployment, poverty, and acute wealth disparities will remain. Suddenly in that scenario, the different interest groups that have coalesced so far behind the doctrine may well start to crumble, or not crumble, but may well start to be more divided among themselves. And I think just as Euclid describes the rich complexity of Greek civil society, the labor movement, the trade unions, the left, so there are two, I think, there's an analogous analysis of the constituencies of the ruling class throughout Europe and the world, which actually contain the seeds of quite important and potentially dangerous conflicts within themselves, but which also those fissures open up space for the left in the period ahead, in my opinion. I'll come back to that point in just a moment. Now, the interesting, to me, point that he makes, which is the most important one, I think, is that we live in a world where not only in the old phrase, you can't have socialism in one country, but you can't have a halfway civilized sort of social democratic society in one country. The utter failure of mainstream social democracy to confront this crisis is because they had already, in the good times, surrendered so much of their own basic position. They had surrendered so much of their own ideas, their own values, that when the crisis hit, they were genuinely nonplussed about what to do. And I think that what Syriza may represent is a new constellation of political forces on the left that doesn't got a clear, in my opinion, historical analogy. You can't say, well, be exactly like, I don't know, the ILP and whatever one wants to look back to. It is novel. It will make its own mistakes, but it contains, certainly at the moment, the all-important kind of chrysalis of hope and of energy and of imagination. And this comes up in this book. So this is a book about the actual struggle as it's being conducted and as it is going to have to be conducted in the period immediately ahead. The third point I want to say is that, of course, it won't come as a surprise to you know me at all, that I welcomed with great relief and support the author's clear warning that the idea that there is some solution by opting out unilaterally from the system, in the sense of saying, if only we can disentangle from the euro and go back to the drachma, and there are important forces on the Greek right that are saying that, very important, some of them potentially dangerous ones, actually dangerous, they might be potentially dangerous, that far from the devaluation route being a route out of poverty and out of the grip of neoliberalism, it almost certainly would consolidate the grip of neoliberalism and make the problem of this economic disempowerment the more entrenched. Nothing would be so dramatic in slashing living standards than a resort to a currency that was dumpable anywhere and under whatever circumstances. So the key question remains how the Greek left, with its allies and its comrades and supporters throughout Europe, can unlock the hegemony at the moment of neoliberal ideas as a whole, and how political and social forces can be identified and mobilized to rally around an alternative. And I guess what comes out of this book is a clear statement about the centrality of what you might call transitional politics. Now, to those of us in a certain tradition, transitional demands were something that one talked about. But what we're actually talking about, if we're honest, is a much more protracted period of a transitional politics between one economic system and another. It simply is, would be a kind of a utopian fiction to imagine that there is any simplistic sudden break, certainly at a national level, that will in and of itself completely transform the social service, the balance of forces. Now, in this situation, just to return to my point, because this is where I would be interested to explore with our two Greek comrades and contributors here, is how we and everybody else can assist in exploiting some of these looming divisions of opinion in the monolith of the system at the moment. If I'm honest, a key factor will be how the German debate can be shifted, the domestic German political debate. And here, quite interesting, because suddenly, just like Greek comrades couldn't have predicted the form that the struggle took in detail in Greece, so we may be surprised at some of the consequences of the German debate on the Greek issue. In the next week, we'll hear whether the Social Democrats have finally done a deal with Merkel. What is really interesting is that to add pressure to their weak bargaining position, they've lifted the ban on Die Linke, the German left party. Not that, by the way, I'm saying there's any one of these groups that is a kind of open sesame to salvation, but what it means is there is likely to be, whenever this government is formed, likely to be a rather different German debate about economic policy and so on, and about the quite obscene reality of the failure of neoliberalist austerity to deliver what they said they were going to deliver. It is now running at least 3 to 5 years behind the time schedule we were given when these policies were initially announced as likely to produce results in terms of a dramatic turnaround. So that's the first point. And what is true in Germany is true in a number of other countries. Some of the governments that have signed up to the austerity strategy, I'm thinking of the French government, are actually looking for excuses to back off it. Not for any reasons of principle, but because it ain't working for them, and their position in office, Hollande, etc., is now seriously at risk. And they see the rise of right-wing populism. The longer this crisis goes on, the more susceptible they are to loss of support to those new social, dangerous social forces on the far right, let alone the Sturmabteilung from Golden Dawn, or Jobbik in Hungary, parading around the streets at the moment. So in these circumstances, I think in the year ahead, in the immediate period ahead, I think we're likely to see tectonic plates shift. The question is how to build upon them. And this time round, alternative politics has to be about more than slogans. It has to be about developing, in support of our Greek comrades in the first instance, very concrete ideas on what the alternatives would look like in practice. In practice, what they would look like if implemented with a reasonable degree of support at European level and so on. And I think that this may well be there may well be possibilities opening up for this in the immediate future. Let's discuss this briefly with Euclid and his comrades. It seems to me the thinking left throughout Europe that has expertise, because one of the few advantages of the maturation of the left in age terms in Europe is that there are people who know a fair bit about specific subjects. We need tax experts. We on the fiddling and how to deal with it. We need people about how to unlock the monstrous regiments of frozen capital in the big corporations. Now mind that they're conspicuous consumption. They're not even consuming the bloody profits, let alone investing them. Those kind of issues. How a sustainable green economy could produce jobs in the concrete environmental and geological and social context of Greece. I mean, these are just three at random I've thrown out. There are a myriad of questions. It seems to me that solidarity this time is certainly about demonstrations. It's certainly about mounting opposition to the neoliberal doctrines across the political spectrum, but it also has to be too pretentious about this. We need an international brigade of people who will be thinking and working in support of the Greek left in very, very specific and practical terms in the period ahead.
Thanks.
In November 2008, after the collapse of Lehman Brothers and financial collapse more generally, the Queen went to the London School of Economics, a heartland of neoliberal orthodoxy, and apparently asked, there was a reception about this or that, asked a senior economist, whose name has not been revealed, how come that you guys, with this amazing wisdom and the evidence and empirical stuff you have, could not predict that huge catastrophe that happened upon the world? It was a fair question, because coming up to the 2008, August 2008, to the, as it were, the peak of the crisis, a number of mainstream economists, both here and in the United States, had repeatedly said that everything is absolutely fine, don't worry, stay calm, and keep investing. Indeed, Greenspan, the governor of the Fed, stated in late August of 2008 that the economic system is sound, people should have trust and go on acting normally. Keep calm. That was the thing. So, the Queen plays the role of the little child in Andersen's tale, The Emperor's New Clothes. She sees that something big is happening here, and those great experts and scientists and people who know the truth basically have no fucking clue about it. So there is a problem there. She becomes the demystifier, the debunker, as Euclid put it, of that whole supposed science, or that particular part of the science. Now, a year later, in 2009, the British Academy set up a seminar precisely to discuss the Queen's question. Now, we do not have the minutes of that seminar, no report was published. However, the press reported, that was in a sense a leak from the participants, senior economists, that they concluded at the end that a failure of collective imagination of many bright people led to their inability to understand the risks to the system as a whole. Interestingly enough, Greenspan, in October of 2008, was brought before a committee of the Senate. And he was more or less asked the same question. How come, the Queen's question, Euclid's question, how come that you did not predict what happened? And Greenspan's answer was very similar, in a sense, to the British answer. I found a flaw in the model I used to perceive how the world, in order to perceive how the world works. I made a mistake in presuming that the self-interest of organizations, banks and others, were best capable of protecting the shareholders and their equity. So we have here an admission by some of the key players of the economic discipline that basically what we can call the ideology was wrong. Now, what is ideology? Take in a pretty straightforward, of course not, Althusserian definition, I would say that ideology is the imaginary way through which we relate to our real conditions of existence. So all of us have an ideology, and clearly the imagination behind the mainstream ideology did not work. But it becomes worse, because you would say that after the system was revealed to be flawed, as they accept that ideological system, somehow people would draw back and would say, we have to abandon it, or we have somehow to remedy it, or, you know, sort of to improve it here and there. And this is precisely, again, where the book of Euclid and Christos and John's comments make it clear that precisely the opposite happened. They knew, as we learned from the Wall Street Journal leak, that the austerity system in Greece, the austerity measures would not work. They knew, I mean, one of the most obvious problems that has become public, and Euclid writes about it, the IMF admitted that their fiscal multiplier was wrong by a factor of 3. And then they go on doing it. So here we have a slight, in a sense, it seems to me, variation on the principle of ideology, which is the imaginary relation to your real conditions of existence, and we can call it cynical ideology. The idea that I know what I'm saying is wrong, but I'm still going on and do it. I believe it, still going on and do it. So that is what I would call cynical ideology. And quite openly, the major way through which the mainstream people and the mainstream economists are acting in this particular sense. Now, why, however, do other people accept it? Not the economists, not the people who, in a sense, are seduced into that system, either out of self or class interest, or out of some kind, other kind of perversion. Freud, and I'm becoming a bit too abstract here, but then I'm a philosopher, not an economist. Freud calls this, what I'm describing here, the fetishistic disavowal. The fetishistic disavowal is a particular type of perversion where someone says, I know what you're saying is totally wrong, it's shit, it doesn't make any sense, but because of who you are, I still accept it. So here we have a distinction, a differentiation between the content of a statement and the position of the enunciator. They are the economists. They are the truth tellers. They have objective knowledge, objective truth. And even if the evidence, as the Queen and Euclid clearly shows, does not match the theoretical perspective, so much the worse for the evidence. And this is where we are here now. We have a kind of discipline that claims objectivity, that claims to be able to predict what is likely to happen in the world. Indeed, Mr. Lucas, Professor Lucas, who got the Nobel Prize for economics about 6 or 7 years ago, claimed that economics has resolved the problem of depression prevention. So we have this kind of theoretical approach that is dominant, that it is totally hegemonic, and claims that we have worked out the world. And this is precisely then the first part of my, in a sense, intervention, where Euclid's work, by showing that economics is not the kind sort of one objective science, that there are different ways, different ideological and indeed class positions from which you can see and explain and then interpret, which is the most important point, different, the same phenomena, the same empirical evidence, that clearly I think makes a huge intervention in precisely undermining what I call the fetishistic disavowal, that you have now to accept that if for such a long period of time there is a huge gap between the evidence and the theoretical model, the problem is no longer with the evidence, it is with the theoretical model. So clearly here we're having a theoretical epistemological and ideological intervention, and it seems to me it works. And I want to finish by now changing back and moving to the political part of the situation. Because for us, like John, all the radicals, theory is precisely a political weapon. I don't write books just to write books, you know, and show how erudite I am, which I am, but I mean, you know, that's not my business. My business is to write books precisely to intervene. And what I think Euclid's and Christos's book shows is that precisely, and here I make a number of rather extreme statements, in Greece at least, we are at an end, at the end game of a particular power system which has clearly outlived its purpose. It has become obsolete, and to use an expression that may sound a bit strange, it now survives as a zombie. It now survives in a posthumous state. It has died, it is no longer there, but it still survives through injections of blood here and there, and eventually someone will kick it out of the way. But its existence is now the existence of a walking man dead. Now, how can I say that? I'm speaking as a philosopher. And I have understood from Hegel, and even from Marx, that at certain points of human history, a system, a socio-economic and political system of power, reaches an end, it becomes obsolete or redundant. This is the great analysis of the French Revolution that we have. And at that point, in order for the final kick to be applied, you need three factors to come together. The first is a strong political desire. And it's absolutely clear that in Greece that exists. There is a strong political desire to get rid, not just of this government, but of the old, the ancien regime, the way in which, you know, that system is operating. The second is you need a political subject. And Syriza has become the political subject. Not particularly because they've done great things, or we've done great things between 2010 and 2012. They were adopted by the people. The political desire was there, and the political desire had to find a subject, and Syriza was adopted. The people could have adopted the Communist Party or some other party. They adopted Syriza, but the subject is there. And the third is that we need a catalyst. The catalyst that will bring together the political desire of the people and the political subject, and with the timeliness of the Aristotelian kairos, of the timely moment, of the opportune moment, will bring the two together and lead to the change. It seems to me that we're precisely at this point now, and by now, I don't mean now in the sense of in the next 3 months or 6 months or whenever there are elections. I'm talking in philosophical terms, that we have the end of that system, and of course, that end leads to a change. Now, how long it will take to get to that change, I don't know. You cannot predict. Philosophy cannot allow you to do it, and economics tries to predict and gets it wrong every single time. So is Syriza ready to do it? This is the key question. I was in Munich, actually speaking last Friday, in a huge biennial theater festival, which on this particular occasion was called Rise Up, and was dedicated to resistances, and there were 2,000 people. And I was speaking about similar ideas, and someone asks me, is the Greek left ready? And my answer is this, and here I'm finishing. You are never ready to fall in love or to start a revolution. There are things in life like a miracle, like an earthquake, something that hits you on the head, the coup de foudre, as the French call the love at first sight. You know, you don't know that you're going to walk out here and find a person to fall in love with. This is what's happened to Syriza. It has been adopted as a result of this huge series of resistances and struggles that Euclid spoke, starting from the major insurrection in December of 2008 in Athens after the murder of the young boy in central Athens, moving to the most important resistance act that immigrants in Europe ever carried out, the Hepatia hunger strike, 300 immigrants shown, which led historically, and I'm a lawyer, into the first case of mass legalization of sans-papier undocumented immigrants. It has not been repeated since then. But it was precisely those people who had a strike with the solidarity of the Greek people, the Greek left, the social civil society and so on that led to that, and of course the squares. But the squares were not just a little thing, you know, a bit like St. Paul's here or Zuccotti Park in Europe. These were important. The squares were the place in which the whole of Greek society, every single part of Greek society was represented, lots of kids, lots of women, lots of people from every class and so on, and basically the message that a kind of 200-old representative democracy has to be supplemented with direct democratic institutions, with direct participation and so on, became now part, essentially, the common sense, of the common sense of the matter, and even there are now discussions about constitutional amendments to this effect. So if you put all these things together, which are part of what I called earlier the philosophical demise, the philosophical death of the system of power, of the wider socio-political system of power, it seems to me that we're now at a stage in which the future of Greece is the future of Europe. Either Greece will, in a sense, follow the road of resistance that Euclid and Christos so well both describe, but also strategically plan out and map out and so on. And of course then they become the catalyst in their own, they're on their own turn for developments in the rest of Europe. Or of course, if that historical nascency becomes miscarries, becomes stillborn, then I think that all of us in the rest of Europe are going to suffer, I think, in a way that we cannot imagine at the minute. So in that sense, Greece is the future of Europe, one of the two ways. Either resistance, victory, and the beginning of a creation of a new kind of approach of democratic socialism that has no precedent, has no guidebook, has no blueprint, but has people like John Palmer there, who are old and wise, and therefore can come in and give us, or Robin Murray here, or Doreen Massey there, and give advice to the Greeks about those specificities. But these are important. But what I think keeps this book going, and keeps Syriza going, is not just the specificities of social policy, of which, again, you can get loads. It is that responsibility and that feeling of hope of a certain utopia which is already part of where we are. And that feeling of hope and utopia that Euclid, both as a theorist and an economist, a good economist, and as a politician represents, is for me the great message that this book, Syriza and Euclid, bring to the rest of Europe today. Thank you.
I mean, I think one of the big issues at stake is it's almost about identity, political identities. And in the book you talk about the need for constructing a European people. I mean, I totally agree with that. The need to construct a people is an essential part of a political programme. And I go around Europe giving talks at various places, and even on the left, people's prime identification is still national. Mm. Over and over again. And the dislike of Merkel is often because she's German and not because of what she stands for in terms of class. Mm. And there's a real need here for us to challenge the terms of the debate about Europe. In this country too, it's always about North versus South, or Britain versus other countries. It's always a spatial, I mean, I'm a geographer and I resent this, it's always a geographical identity rather than a class and a political identity. And I just think that we need, I mean, it isn't really a question, but it's we need to think about how we can intervene in debates at every point we can in order to try and shift that mode of political identification. And if people have any ideas, I think we ought to get going on it, because it's a huge obstacle, even on the left.
I gather it's a semi-technical question about the debt, actually, in terms of Greece. I think it's right to say that when you refer to the IMF conference and discussion saying the purpose of the operation back in 2010 was to rescue the French and German banks, is it not the case that that has actually happened? That if, in effect, if I read something in the Financial Times recently, they have socialised the debt in the sense that the bulk of the public sector debt, at least, is now in the hands of the state, the Troika, the whatever, the various European institutions. So that's the first question. The second question is, well, I mean, I could get into the debate about leaving the euro, because I would question your position on this, but I really wanted to make a specific challenge, really, which is you associate, it may have been John Palmer, actually, the alternative relies on a vision of somehow the political tensions within the rest of the European Union, yeah, getting to a point where there will be splits, Hollande or whatever, will suddenly see the light and realise that austerity, or has already seen the light but can't, will finally go there and agree to a serious negotiation about the debt. I have to say I'm deeply sceptical about that. I don't see any serious evidence of any shift within the northern, if you like, elites in the European Union that indicates that they are in any sense willing to make serious concessions, but a threat of leaving the euro remains a leverage, gives Greece potentially a degree of leverage which should surely not be simply put to one side.
I've noticed that you've all stressed, there's a need for expertise for Greece to provide, advice and policy and directions. And you equally stressed participation. So, in my field is healthcare, and I've studied participation in healthcare. So, there, the assumption tends to be that participation challenges expertise. So I'm just wondering if you have any comments on how this might pan out in a kind of policy arena. Thanks.
I want to start with this social democracy thing and who the partners are, and also to John, who also said something about that. And there's a $64 million question that Christos and I set ourselves 2 or 3 years ago, and that was, why didn't social democracy make a comeback after the crisis in 2008? Why didn't they say, okay, we've been led by the new neoliberals, we didn't have much, they were on top, the banks, why didn't they make a return? Now, there's obviously lots of argument, like the cognitive lock-in that I've already mentioned. There's also that they might want to win elections, they still think, and that generally they might not believe there is an alternative. So if you're a person that thinks that there is an alternative, is there a deeper argument? And I think there is a deeper argument. And if I ever get back to university, it's what I want to do research on. It's quite difficult to work it out. This is our thesis, and it's only a thesis. It's not an argument that I would support strongly. But what would be a social democratic policy? We could all do it. I think we could. You would want to regulate the banks. You would want a partial decommodification in health and education, public sectors, and some kind of minimum wage. So we all know it. We reckon with Christos that if you did the research properly, and I'm not going to go in why it's difficult, if some student wants to do this, and I'll tell them why it's difficult, that after the 70s, the return of profitability in capitalism came through, not that textiles were more profitable now, they made them profitable again, or steel, or car, but through the expansion in the financial market. So of all American profits, in 1970, 10% were banking profits. By 2000 and whatever, 8, I think, it's 40%. In health, private health,
yep.
And in private education,
yep.
Of all levels, yeah, primary, university, technical, thing. So if you cut that off, so you yep. say, a new deal, it's okay, we'll have capitalism, but you know, the private sector can't go so far into education, can't so far into health, and the banks are regulated. I'm not sure that that's a stable equilibrium. So that's a deeper analysis. It's a thesis. It's not an answer because, like I said there, so that the issue is quite. So we reckon, together with Gostas, not the bit that he says I'm like the Queen, the bit that he says that that there are that something new is opening out, that there is no central ground. That there is no viable social democracy, not because I think they're horrid people and things, there is no within, so that what we're seeing is, how did he put it, the three things that you need to do this big change, yes, that he said you have to have a subject and you have to have a need to do it and so on. We think with that in that kind of phase. So I don't expect to see, I don't know, John will know more about this, so I won't answer that second bit on the shift in Northern. I don't expect to see very big shifts in the Northern Social Democrats. I unless we get to similar things that we are seeing, as in Syriza. So now, at the moment in Portugal, the Bloco, together with the Communist Party, which is mercifully nothing to, like our Greek Communist Party, are getting close to 20%. Yeah, 18 to 20%. The Spanish left has a trajectory just like ours. I mean, in Galicia, which is Rajoy's stronghold, and the left used to get as much as it used to get in Castilla. To English people, that won't mean it's like the Communist Party doing well, I don't know, in Buckinghamshire or something. that kind of they got together a Syriza. They actually said, we'll get, so this is Galicia local elections, and they got 10% or 9% from 0.4 or something, or 0.3 or something. So I think that may then pressurize, but I think it's going to have to come outside first. I agree with the skepticism. Who was it who did? Yep, the skepticism of that, but I'll be interested to see whether that goes. A quick question on the banks, and then I'll get back to one or two things and finish. Yes, they've passed on a lot of the debt to the state, but they're still in real trouble. Yeah, they're real, and it's nothing to do now with Greek. I mean, so the answer to you is, has it worked, their exposure to Greek bonds? If that's the question, then they are much less exposed to Greek bonds, so they don't care that much for whatever happens to Greece now. So in that sense, it's worked. But the German and French banks, as I understand it, are still in trouble. I don't know if you're the, this was a financial question, so what, yes and no is the answer to that question. Now I want to, because I'm speaking too much, to say something which adds from Vespina to Robin. So Vespina asks, yeah, but you can't have it both ways, she says, yeah? Yeah, you can't have her write a book about all how important down up and contribution and participation and ordinary people and the anti-global movement, and then say that the solution is an expertise. Yeah, you can't do that. I would say that that perhaps you can have both ways. I mean, just like Gramsci says, what does Gramsci says, an intellectualist? The people here who know much more about Gramsci than I do, but paraphrasing grotesquely, he says that what intellectuals do and what scientists do in a left-wing approach is not that they sit in their ivory tower and they think of theories, but they reflect, simplify, codify, expand, and I don't know what other words he uses, the experience of the working class movement. I mean, we wouldn't now say just the working class movement, we'd say all movements, yeah? Of the globalization movement, or the in favor of public goods movement, or whatever movement. So what intellectuals do in Gramsci, so there is a role for intellectuals, is that these intellectuals take what the movement is trying to do, and they try to make it, make it into scientific terms, but it's not a separate thing. They haven't sat out, in their ivory tower and said that. And I would say that's what we need experts, what Robin and John and whoever else has mentioned it is saying, and I agree with this, what was it, Academy? barefoot series, I can't imagine. I would expect the same kind of interplay that you need. So you know, we have a movement now to stop water privatization. We would need this academy to provide people to say, well, what are the new issues in water? You know, the movements know a bit, the experts know a bit, and how that works, and so on and so forth. If you think that, I mean, I think this question is important, by the way, because I think that you could get it wrong. You could get it's not like I know the answer to that, and I can think of us getting it terribly wrong both ways, by the way. Mm. We could get it.
Yeah.
Yes, we could get it. I'm not saying one way we could get it wrong. We could also get it wrong the other way. Finally, on Doreen's question, which is, I remind you what Doreen's question is. Yes, Euclid, but yeah, people don't think about European. They think about themselves on the national level. I think this has to do that the left hasn't thought seriously enough about globalization, what you do about it, and integration, what you do about it. If you want a not particularly leftist book, which I think has an excellent last 100 pages, which I think has the elements of the answer, this isn't in the book, by the way, it's Danny Roderick's The Paradox of Globalization. And what does Danny Roderick say in the last 100 pages? He says it for the world economy, and he's a bit sort of uncertain of what he wants to say about Europe. He says that if you want to keep the good things in globalization, which we can mention what the good are, the exchange of information and ideas and experiments and so on, and you don't want the bad things, you've got to put some limits. And those limits are that regions or localities have to have some protection, a sort of infant industry argument for some of you who understand this, protection for social experimentation. So I think if you're going to have a European identity, you could build on Roderick's work and have, as well as the macro bits that we always talk about, because the weakness of the left and my left, as well as most of the left here, is usually when you say, well, so what do you want to see as a European architecture, a different European economic franchise? So you talk about Eurobonds, you talk about the ECB being different, or you talk about fiscal transfers. Yes, that's what you do, John. I'm not exaggerating here. That's the kind of thing. What you don't have is an architectural intervention which says that there has to be, I mean, building on some of the limits there are. So for instance, you can't use public procurements to help your own workers, but there are exceptions to that. You can use public procurement to help your workers if you want to build up the skill base, or if there's a particular high level of unemployment. My view, to make integration work and keep the globalization, is the left needs a serious view of a structure which is democratic and which allows social experimentation, economic experimentation on different prototypes. And why is it democratic? Because what is the argument of the right against such a... Yeah, I mean, the right's argument will be this is a return to protectionism and going back to the... But what's the serious argument? That protectionism usually helps specialised interests. So you put a tariff or you protect, and you don't really help working people, you help a particular industry, and there's a transfer of resources from consumers or workers to those industries. So that's why it has to be democratic. Because if everybody is represented, the social interest, the protection you need will be for local growth strategies, for supporting social experimentation, for supporting alternative consumption and production prototypes. That's what I think that if we strengthen that, people would see that there's a way in which globalization, it can be a European citizen, that is not in conflict with a local growth and productive strategy. That's my...
One place to look is the kind of mosaic of alliances in Latin America, which retains a sense of place, a sense of national identity, but doesn't lock them into a free trade area. And it's just a thing to look at.
Yeah. What in Latin America?
Latin America.
Alba.
The Alba. This is what I missed.
There's all these overlapping.
Yeah, that's what I missed. I missed the Alba. Yeah, okay.
Okay, John.
We're at the absolute kernel of the political challenge when the question is asked, okay, well, where are these allies and where are these forces going to come from? I think, and it is a huge question. However, notice what is happening to public opinion. Measurements by opinion pollsters, I just read a YouGov thing on attitudes to the rich, to bankers. I mean, it is incredible. Across the spectrum, the hostility to the elite, expressed in different ways, even among some conservative voters, as well as the right-wing populists, by the way, and as well as on the centre and the left, is formidable. And it's across, it's happening, as far as I can see, across Europe. For a mixture of different reasons, but there is a common discontent rising. Number one. Number two, I think it really is the case that there are cracks beginning to appear on how long this strategy can be maintained, on precisely what can do. And I'll tell you one of the reasons why they can't wash their hands of Greece, simply because the debts have been transferred out of the hands of the banks. That if anything did happen to Greece, all hell would break loose in Spain, in Portugal, in Italy, in Ireland, and now probably in France, because the structures are weakening, the structures of the present policy are weakening the French economic system. So I think that these things are going to develop, and I think we will see, next year, I think we'll see those deepen. The trick is how to capture the imagination of people that this is an opportunity to work on an alternative.
That's it.
I mean, that is it. And I don't think the traditional left forms of mobilization quite capture how to do this, to be absolutely honest with you. Here we may have more to learn than to help Syriza. I may have to learn from Syriza. But I think that in the alliances between the world of ideas and the social movements and the labour movement lies still a vast under-exploited, under-utilised body of gold, if you like, in terms of ideas. And because those individuals haven't come through the political radar of the left in the past, in their 30s and 40s and even in their 50s, you know, those of us of a certain vintage did, because that's how you emerged into political activity. So it's much more difficult for us to, they're at one level invisible, but at the same time they're all around us. So the question is how to do it. And here, you know, perhaps this is the former, the old journalist in me that's thinking, a Syriza appeal, and this, I mean an appeal not put out on a Friday night in Athens on the leaflets to follow and so on, but something really considered and with support in the other European countries, that Europe's got to turn. We are going to fight. And if we're in power, we're going to confront, you know, I think there may be a little bit more room to go up to the wire with a primary budget surplus. This is now something that relates to a discussion that we've had elsewhere in Greece. I don't want to pursue that too far, but I think that it may be possible to capture the imagination. It's strange how things come from nowhere. It's like in Brazil, when that movement, I mean, there was no decision of any central committee taken by correct forms of democratic centralism to mobilize 3.5 million people overnight on the street. If you ask them where do they come from, no one would tell them, they wouldn't have a clue. They came from everywhere, and so on. So there is that bubbling away, maybe untutored politically, certainly unorganized politically, and capable of holding simultaneously contradictory views on a variety of subjects. That's characteristic of the new movements. But I think that there are times when circumstances come together, and I think real effort and resources put into a political appeal for we must be able to live better than this. We must be able to live better than people not getting medicines that they need that exist. We must be able to live better than this when there are millions stacked up in the big capitalist organizations which are not being used for bad purposes, let alone good purposes, they're not being used for any bloody purposes. There must be a better way to do this when the rich are getting so much richer, we have to capture a way of taxing them. There must be a better way of doing it when so much is being wasted in wars and defense and a trident in our case and all these other ludicrous pantomime obscenities from the 19th century. Sometimes when the circumstances come together, it is something like a very imaginative appeal combined with where we've got, and this is my last one, we've got to sort of focus in on the questions that Euclid and others have raised, Robin and others have raised, finding people who are able to have at least a view on how things might be run better in this sector, in that area, in this part of policy, who are not experts on introducing socialism, they're experts on how to democratize and improve the health service, how to tackle the drugs companies, whatever it is, things I know nothing about. There are people who know a lot about, and there are practitioners who know a lot about it, and there are practitioners who are not necessarily of the formal left who can be mobilized for this. But it needs a kind of appeal to catch the sense of there must be a better way forward, which I think is becoming the mood in a variety of countries. And really worries me if we don't do it, and the center pussyfoots round trying to blunt a bit of the rough edges of neoliberalism without actually challenging anything, then there will be a serious challenge from the right. It won't be this next election. It'll be the one after or the one after that. You know, I've drawn the analogy before now of 1936, when the Popular Front came in. Their failure was finally what opened the door to Pétain in France. And we know what kind of people are poised in Greece and elsewhere here. So I think that's the sort of moment that I think we may be entering, where within the run-up to the election, something that says, come and help us, we must work together, there must be a better, more fundamental way. And appealing to people in medicine, appealing to people in engineering, or whatever, that, you know, making it clear you're addressing large constituencies that may not form part of the traditional left marketplace.